Look, Donnie, I like you.
Like? I like you!
That's the thing, I like you too.
Donnie!
There's a lot of things about me you don't know anything about, Donnie. Things you wouldn't understand. Things you couldn't understand.
Things you shouldn't understand.
I don't understand.
TBTL.
Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is?
It's Friday. Friday. Gotta get down on Friday. Everybody's looking forward to the weekend.
There are two types of people in this world. Those who like Neil Diamond and those who don't. My ex-wife loves him.
You know something? That was pretty funny. You should think about being a comedian.
My friend is a blackjack dealer, and on his forearm, he has a tattoo of an ace and a jack. You see, I'm a blackjack player. On my forearm, I'm going to get a tattoo of a 10 and a 2. And then maybe later, a king.
You know how someone might describe a situation that's unpleasant or confining as being like a prison? This is what they're referring to.
All right. Hello, good morning, and welcome, everyone, to a Friday edition of TBTL, the show that just might be too beautiful to live. My name is Luke Burbank. I am your host.
Definitely.
Coming to you from the offices of Walsh, Walsh, and Doormat.
Bring it back home, baby. Bring it back home.
Right here in the beautiful Seattle area, where it is actually looking like a pretty nice day. Of what I can see, of what I was able to take in on the Lyft ride over here. We have a fun Friday edition of the program coming your way. It's episode 4,173 in a collector's series.
Let the fun begin.
I'm in a good mood this morning, but boy, was I ever fuming, as our friends across the water like to say. I was fuming last night when the Seattle Mariners were kicking off the regular season. And I went to turn it on my television, and I could not seem to get it going.
Television is no friend of mine.
And it was because apparently I wasn't yet paying the Comcast Corporation thousands and thousands of dollars to get this baseball footage. And so I said, all right, well, you've got me. I'll pay the thousands and thousands of dollars. And then
you gotta be kidding me.
They wouldn't accept my thousands and thousands of dollars. So I'm going to really let them have it here today on the program. Speaking of really letting them have it, or maybe not letting them have it, Costco's going to start IDing in their food court.
What's courageous about eating a hot dog?
We're going to talk about that, mostly as show prep for me before I go over to KUOW later today. And then, and I can't mention this enough, on to Livewire at Town Hall tonight. Come on by if you're curious. It's going to be a fun show. This guy always makes it a fun show. He's the longest-running Cobro of the program, maybe best known for his depictions of the tall ships. He really came through in the pinch for me last night due to his extra-legal baseball viewing techniques. He's Andrew Walsh, and he's joining me right now. Good morning, my friend.
Good morning. You might not have noticed it, and it might have been lost in the music, but I just had my own hot mic moment. Usually, you are not here in studio with me. My mic is muted until the very last moment. But a second ago, you said, this guy's always a lot of fun. And I went, And that's how I realized my mic was already open. I don't know if anybody will hear that or not, but you can feel free.
You got to eat that microphone.
Don't rewind to find out if you can hear that. I would finish listening to this show all the way through, then go back and re-download and re-listen.
Clear your cache.
Clear your cache. Make sure go to a
clear your cookies.
Go to a different cell phone. Stand beneath a different cell phone.
Borrow or steal any cell phone from anyone in your life or out of your life, and go ahead and subscribe them to the program, please.
I have a growth opportunity for us, maybe.
I'm glad that opportunity came at the end of that sentence.
And it was, I have a growth.
I thought you were trying to tell me something.
I have a growth, and since you're here,
yes.
I was wondering if you could maybe take a look at it, glance it if need be. This is a little negative, and maybe you won't like it, but I'll take a download however we get a download or a stream or whatever they call it. I'm good at business of podcasting.
Yeah.
What about TBTL as a mandated... All right, punishment is a strong word,
right.
But let's say you have some kids in the house, kids who are old enough to listen to the content that we're putting out there, which I think is most kids want, probably have some interest in colonoscopies and when we're going to
schedule.
And also, like, getting into the scheduling of colonoscopies.
What about discussing Riverside?
And Riverside and other exciting internet apps like that. So anyway, I'm just sort of thinking, like, if
kids in fantasy,
you have a kid and you need to, like, kind of steer them in the right direction. Maybe their grades aren't so. You need to, like, kind of ground them.
You need to scare them straight.
Straight a little bit. Maybe you just make them listen to TBTL. We get the downloads.
Uh-huh.
They get a couple of father figures in their life, in addition to whoever else is already in their life.
They get a view into just how bad it can get for them if they don't figure their life out.
Scared straight now.
That's the scared straight aspect. It's like, you know, I thought I knew it all when I was your age. I thought I'd never be podcasting in a basement.
That's right. The other day, I got to ask you, the other day when we were talking about lighting, you were like, I don't want to look like I'm podcasting from a basement. Were you directly saying that to insult me? Or did you just say that while I was talking to you from a basement studio?
You know, I think I meant that. First of all, I have no memory of saying that. I commonly kind of warg out during the show. And I think I meant that more
it's okay.
as
I
the general statement
the
around the knock on podcasting. But this is the thing, Andrew, and we like to make the joke that this is, you know, obviously a highly visual medium, although it's getting more visual by the day because we're putting these little videos out. If you'd like to see me dancing and trying to kick my leg up into the view of the camera from yesterday's show, you can go to the TBTL Instagram page and subscribe. Like and subscribe. But
make your kids do it as punishment.
Exactly. but now we're not only are we doing things more visual, but we're talking about things that are visual more, like what our light setup is, what our camera setup, how we like our backgrounds. And I will just say this. I actually, yes, we are on the lower floor of your beautiful home you and Genevieve share, but it's a great backdrop. I love you have this wood paneling in here that I think is just visually very interesting.
On the other end of the Zoom or whatever we're talking on when we're doing Riverside. Sorry.
Yeah,
kids.
There's nothing there's nothing that feels in a bad way basement-y about when you're broadcasting from here. And in fact, I'm a bit jealous because it's what you have is essentially an accent wall behind you. You know what I mean? Like it's
You don't know until you come in the room that it's all accent wall.
It's an accent room.
It's actually more of a sauna, but yeah.
But I like it. I'm also I'm a fan of like and it's not you don't have paneling in here because what you have is tongue and groove wood. Like this is the real deal. This is the relevant conversation of our time.
That's right.
Like it's not wood paneling where you buy these sheets of something that looks like it's different pieces of wood fit together. You've got the real deal in here. You've got tongue and groove. If we were to take this stuff apart, it fits together in a way that took somebody some time to piece together. And you've got the high quality version of this going on. And I truthfully am very much a fan of the look of it, of the vibe.
Well, thank you. I kind of put you on the spot to say that. I was going to...
My backdrop, which people can see if they go to the Instagram page, needs some help. I'm in this...
At least yours says TBTL behind you. I feel like I need something a little bit over here that signifies that I'm doing a podcast.
I have been so distracted and bogged down with other parts of my little remodeling project that, you know, the cobbler's children go without shoes. And the very place that is most filmed in my life now, which would be the Madrona Hill studio in the area right behind me, is literally like you can see in the video on Instagram when I'm leg upping, when I'm kicking my foot up in the air, that I just have a couple of different things propped up on cardboard boxes. That is eventually going to be hopefully some sort of a bookshelf situation, very carefully curated. They used to call it in the days of the pandemic a respectability bookshelf.
Oh, really?
Where, because, you know, everybody.
For Zoom, everybody.
Yeah, everybody in meetings and particularly on, like, you know, TV networks like MSNBC, suddenly everyone was at home. It's wild to think of what a radical shift and what a long-term shift that created in television news's idea of where a person needs to be when punditing.
Yeah.
Because it was like
an immediate and fundamental shift, right?
An immediate, fundamental, and now permanent shift, because it turns out it's sort of better for everyone. It used to be the case. I was on our buddy Chris Hayes' show when it was on Saturdays many years ago.
It wasn't called All In, and now I'm blanking on what it was called back then.
It was called Attaboy.
Attaboy. I'm going to look it up. It's driving me, because it's I like the way that the names sort of complemented each other. They felt like they were of the same universe.
Yes.
But
I remember, first of all, I was extremely, extremely flattered to be invited on the show. I have a feeling Pesca might have been on that one with me, or he'd been on other, you know, episodes of the show. It was such a cool show, too, by the way. It was like, it was really a hang. Like, it was just like, it was a couple of hours on a Saturday. The conversation was felt very sort of casual in a way, but hopefully somewhat informative. Have you figured out what it was called?
Yeah, it was Up. It was Up with Chris Hayes.
Up with Chris Hayes.
With Chris Hayes.
And so I remember, again, being, let's be honest, I was only invited on the show because our friend Chris Hayes is a fan of TBTL, but I'll take it.
Mm-hmm. He's like, maybe if I get Luke on the show someday, I'll get to hang out with Andrew. Kind
right.
Of like that.
Precisely.
Kind of
so angle I was
there.
Like, I was super stoked. I think I was already in New York. I don't think it was the case that I had, like, they didn't travel me to New York to do this. But I remember them sending a car to the hotel that I was staying in Manhattan, which I want to say was a half a mile away. And a guy came and picked me up. I felt like Bruce Willis in Die Hard getting picked up by Argyle, the limo driver, who turns out to actually be very critical to the plot.
How did that work out for him, by the way, the Bruce Willis character? Pretty good, right?
Honestly, it repaired his marriage.
That's true. There you go.
I mean, as far as surviving ideas? A terrorist attack... As far as surviving a terrorist event at Nakatomi Plaza,
sure.
The idea that it would forge a lifelong relationship with Reginald Val Johnson and repair your marriage, you could have a worse Saturday.
It's a win-win.
Yeah. So... I remember being, again, all of this felt so so posh to me, because here's a black SUV dispatched by the National Broadcasting Corporation to come pick me up. It's waiting outside my hotel. I get in it, and then it drives. My memory is literally around the block.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think I was very far from 30 Rock, but it picks me up, drives me to, and then it parks, and then I get out and I go, do I call someone after this? And he goes, I'll just be waiting here. And I look, and there's a fleet of these vehicles. Every person who's going to be participating in the television being made at 30 Rock that day has been brought there by one of these guys, and they're just going to wait, and then they're going to take you home. And that was, at the network level, kind of the, I think, sort of the industry standard. Like, if we're going to have a person on this thing, they need to physically be here. Or in a television studio in another place.
Yeah.
But the idea of being in your own home with AirPods in is a non-starter. And then all of a sudden the pandemic, and we had to, and I think then all the TV networks realized, God, we're saving money on SUVs.
And there's, I think, you know, if you're a regular contributor, I'm sure that you are sent a lot of equipment by the network for lighting and audio and all of that stuff. Now I have a question for you. I have one and a half answers to this question myself. Whose, like, kind of Zoom setup do you think of first, or at-home punditry setup do you think of first?
I'll tell you, it's got a good one. Claire McCaskill.
One-time
Missouri Senator Claire McCaskill's got a nice one.
I like her.
What I like about Claire McCaskill's setup is it's not overly curated, but it's not under-curated.
Is it a kind of a study, kind of? It seems like...
I honestly think Claire McCaskill may have two places that she lives. I believe I would guess that she has a place in Missouri. God, I hope she's from Missouri. I hope I'm not misremembering this. She's a senator. She was a senator from the Midwest.
Her. Yeah, yeah.
I feel like what I like, Claire McCaskill, like, probably has a place in D.C. and probably has a place back in her home state. And in both locations, she's in a nice room, but it's not that she has...
Missouri.
Whew. I'm going to try to roll that energy right into KUOW today. As
what's
I go,
going on with
I'm
Boeing?
Thinking it's called Boeing. Correct me if I'm wrong. It's called a Boeing jet. Anyway, I like Claire McCaskill's scene because she doesn't seem to be overly fussy about it, but she's in nice spaces, but she's not in a room that you can tell she fretted over unduly. It's just it's like if you were to go to someone's house and you would be hanging out at their house, it'd be nice to be...
But a nice house, a nice airy house.
But not so fancy that you're afraid to touch anything.
Oh,
but
I'm looking at some of these backdrops here. Sometimes she's in her living room, which is very nice. Sometimes she's in her kitchen with a little coffee pot behind her, but it doesn't look cluttered.
No, I like that. You know who else I really like? and I'm not going to be able to call his name up, but he is he's a lawyer who I think his area of expertise and his focus is on fighting for voting access and voting rights. And he's on Chris's show and other MSNBC shows a fair amount because he's constantly.
He wants people to be able to vote, huh? Must be a liberal.
He's got the woke mind virus where he believes that Americans should be able to vote.
Ugh.
And what I love about this guy is he has a very serious job. He's a very smart lawyer. He's doing very important work, but he's obsessed with his dog.
Oh.
And he constantly works in photos of his dog in the backdrop. I want to say his first name might be Andrew. Which is, if that is his name, it's just coincidence. I'm not making an Andrew Walsh joke here. But like, what I love is he's talking about the very
good one.
He's talking about the very future of democracy. But he's also, you can tell that he wanted to make sure that there was a funny photo or a loving photo of his dog in the background. And they move around too. And it's like his whole backdrop is essentially a shrine to his dog that I'm pretty sure is alive. Like, this isn't just like, you know, rest in power, Puddles. Like, that's the name of one of the children who calls into our show. I'll try to pick a better example.
Yeah.
Although not a bad name for your dog either.
No.
So I do think about these things, Andrew, when I think about creating my special backdrop at the Madrona Hill Studio. I want it to be, I want it to seem put together, but also not like I just ordered it out of a catalog and set it up. I don't want it to be soulless. I want it to be. And that's, again, what I like about down here. I will tell you this, though. I'm surprised that my friend Andrew, Mr. It Is What It Is, has not one, but two ring lights.
I do, yeah.
You're a two ring light man.
I am, yeah. I had this little cheap guy that I got at the Goodwill that I was using just for Zoom stuff. But when you and I started using Riverside, I got a slightly better camera. How do you like my gooseneck stand?
I love it.
Keeps it off of the desk.
I'm very impressed with your setup in here, honestly.
I got the other ring light. I got a makeup crew outside.
Yeah, Glam Squad. They're hiding behind a human door.
I set you up for that question because I wanted to answer it myself.
Yes.
The two that I think of.
Oh, good.
And the one that I think of first, and you're not going to be surprised by this answer at all, but I like that it went from really quick Zoom background, but then it sort of expanded out, as you mentioned, as we all, or as these successful commentators started to kind of build out there. What did you call the shelf behind them again?
Well, it's been called a respectability shelf. There was a whole website called Room Raters.
Oh, yeah.
In the pandemic that was just, and it was a really funny blog because they were just going through and kind of rating with no real metric, which backgrounds they liked the most, but in a really funny way.
But the first one I think of is Mina Kimes.
I was going to say.
You knew it was going to be Mina
Kimes. Bell.
Because originally, here, do you need my bell?
No, that's okay. You can ring
If you're
going to
ring the bell for me and Mina, then you should have it.
We should start a segment.
Again, like,
ring
I
my
think
bell.
when she started, I'm on KOW's podcast Seattle Now with Rachel Bell today, by the way, if you want to check out the podcast. You and I are just owning the KOW space.
God, we are flooding the zone over there.
It was actually, no joke, probably the most fun. I mean, I have fun on that show usually, but it was the whole thing was like a laugh fest. It was like most of the stories with a little bit of city council talk, but most of it was like Mariners food, Hellcat.
I'm a little
Costco
hurt that
hot dogs.
KUOW
like
didn't go for
stuff.
my Hellcat suggestion for today's program.
Maybe because I know that they were covering it. Anyway, point is, Mina Kimes has the Pavement Wowie Zowie album behind her, and I just sort of remember
watching that
go from quick Zoom setup to more professional over time. But Wowie Zowie has maintained a place of honor.
Love it.
It's always in the backdrop, and
love
then
it.
Little tributes to her dog Lenny, which is very nice. And now I think I follow her on Instagram. I think they commissioned somebody to make some art behind her as well that is kind of related. The other one I think of, and this is a little bit of negging, I didn't know this fella's name, but I just looked it up. The fact that I was able to look this up just goes to show that this is not an accident. John Heilman? Is that how you say his name?
John Heilman?
Is he
the political reporter?
He's something on MSNBC, some sort of commentator, because I used to see him a lot.
Yeah.
And what always stood out to me was that he would always prominently have his iPad in front of him.
Yeah,
with
and you have the Wu-Tang.
Yes,
that's
and I have
little,
a friend, and I'm always like, kind of joke, there's something so And, like, I am a white guy that likes the Wu-Tang, but I feel like I'm self-aware enough about it to hopefully not talk about it too much, although I did quote a lyric to you awkwardly the other day from Liquid Swords. But, like, aside from that, it's just, like, there's something about that. I always found it so just kind of like this guy who's probably exactly my age, white guy, but flashing his Wu-Tang whenever he can get on TV just seemed a little, like, I don't know. A brand that I wouldn't lean into.
Well, a couple of things on that. It does feel, by the way, the name of the attorney in question is Mark Elias. So that Andrew joke was not only not funny, it was not even, didn't even make sense.
So you meant the guy I was talking about.
No, the guy who is obsessed with putting his dog in the background is named Mark Elias. And his dog, I just want to figure out what the name of the dog is even, because we'll give that dog a shout out. It looks like it might be a Portuguese water dog of some kind, which we love them. I think the Obamas did a lot for that brand, because Bo, their dog, was a Portuguese water dog. But I will say this. I was, last night, Becca popped by my place because we were going to come up here to Seattle together. And I have this book, this photo book that is somebody put together that's got just kind of pictures from my life. And it was a very nice gesture. It was like, you know, baby pictures and kind of just different. It's different phases of my life. And
but bound like a book.
Yeah, bound like a book with a cover, with a picture of me on the cover where I'm. This is actually a pretty epic photo. I'm a little baby. I'm probably like one. I'm kind of all covered in dirt. We're camping or something. I just have a cob of corn in my mouth, and I'm just wearing a dirty yellow t-shirt that says, "Praise the Lord."
That's pretty awesome.
It's a very epic photo.
Are you holding the corn? Your mouth isn't big enough to, like...
I must be holding the edge of the corn, but I'm biting the corn, too. I am very engaged in that process. But one of the photos in there was from when I weaseled my way into the pages of the New York Times, which was when the Bryant Park Project was being launched. Yeah. The New York Times came and wrote an article about us because the log line was NPR wants to reach a newer audience. Mm-hmm. And I...
How'd that turn out?
Haven't heard much. It did save my marriage. It did end one marriage and start another engagement.
Come to the East Coast, they said. Talk to younger listeners, they
interview
said.
Interview Sigaros, they said. And I spent too much time thinking about what do I want my outfit to say. And what I wanted my outfit to say was, I'm on NPR, but I'm cool. And what did I go with? A Biggie Smalls t-shirt.
Oh, yes. We have talked about this before. I know the shirt, and it is a cool shirt.
It is a cool shirt, but it was try hard in the way that probably John Heilemann's... It's a little try hard with the Wu-Tang baby. They rock the world on the tablet.
Like, sure, yeah.
And I say that to say that I've fallen prey to the exact same thing, which is a way of trying to signal a certain amount of quote unquote getting it or not being in whatever predictable lane you think someone who hosts a public radio show might be in. Mm-hmm. But it was a little bit, you know, at least it's subtle. Here's what I will say. If you didn't know what that t-shirt was, you might not immediately recognize it.
Yeah.
You know, so at least...
Although I guess sort of the same with the Wu-Tang symbol, I guess.
I mean, honestly, if you didn't know that's Wu-Tang, you think he's working with some sort of shadowy cabal.
He's on MSNBC. I already assumed that.
John Heilemann and the Illuminati. But it was just funny because literally last night, Becca was flipping through this book, and I go, yeah, that was a picture of me in the New York Times where I decided I was going to really be a cool guy by wearing my Biggie Smalls t-shirt.
Well, I mean, this is where, I mean, why am I throwing these stones? In fact, the fact that you just told that story reminds me that I've gone after this John Heilemann guy on the show before. I knew I have an inside joke with a friend where I would send her a screen cap of it whenever I saw it. But, you know, like, who am I to say that I'm so above it? You know what I mean? Like, I do like the Wu-Tang Clan. You know, I like Biggie Smalls.
They rock
like
the world.
I believe that they rock the world. Yeah. So it's like, I am that guy. Maybe that's why it stood out to me so much is because...
Right, because
like,
it's kind of
like...
the
things that make me cringe about other people probably are things that
always
make me cringe about myself,
right?
And so that's probably it. Oh, you promised me.
That by the way, that's a real making you dig your own grave move. I played the drop and it was too low, and you're
oh yeah, I
your
instinctively
only
raised it for you. What am I doing?
Your fidelity concerns trump your hating that drop concerns, and so you
just muscle memory. You watch me.
You were like, you're like, this audio drop that I hate deeply is not loud enough. Let me make sure that it's audible to everyone, even though I hate this with the fire of a thousand suns.
Luke, we have to talk about what happened to you and America last night regarding trying to watch baseball in the Pacific Northwest. I'm also really concerned about your time. You're supposed to be at KUOW in like about an hour.
Yeah, but the bigger issue is I've read none of the articles.
Right, that too. So
which
maybe
we could even get into. Like, I had, Andrew, I rarely have stress dreams anymore because I don't dream, but because I'm dead inside. But I actually had a little stress dream about this very thing, which is going to be on KUOW a little bit later today. And the stress dream was, I only realized at the beginning of as the music was playing and Bill Radke, the host, was talking, that was the moment at which I realized I hadn't read any of the articles.
You had a stress dream about this.
Yeah, like two nights ago. And in my dream,
I was pretty chill.
And this is what this is, of course, how stress dreams always work for me. It's something is about to happen that I was unprepared for.
Mm-hmm.
And my fixation becomes getting some kind of information or tool that will help me fix the problem or at least feel a little better about
like
it.
Like a pencil, right?
Did you
have a pencil?
Pencil's
one
a big one. Yep. For me, it's I'm in a room and I realize, oh, there's stand-up comedy going on and I am supposed to, I didn't know I'm the next person to go up. Mm-hmm. And my fixation becomes if I can get a pencil and paper, I can write down some ideas so when I go up there, at least I'll have some sense. And the dream that I had about this KUOW thing was I realize as the show is beginning that I'm on the show and that I haven't read any of the articles, but we're going into the newscast. Mm-hmm. So that's 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And if I can get, and when I used to be on Ross and Burbank, that would be more prep time than I
was
going to
say. I would have taken that. God, that would have been like, great if I could have gotten you to do.
And in the dream, I was just like, I got to get a list of these articles.
Uh-huh.
They're simply too good.
Good.
I was like, I got to get I need the links.
Mm-hmm.
I was like Oscar Schindler, the links are life. I think those are on the same level.
Sure.
I was like, gotta get these links because if I can get these links to the articles, then I can speed read these five articles during the next 5 minutes and then I'll figure it out from there, but I just need enough to go on. And I didn't get enough to go on. And then I guess this is ironical.
Ironic.
A lot of people think it's ironical that we work at a travel agency, but we've never been outside of Missouri.
What is that from?
That's Fred Willard in Waiting for Guffman. Because Ron and Sheila Albertson run a travel agency, but they've never been outside of, I think, even like, yeah, Missouri.
Mm-hmm. Hey, that's where Claire McCaskill is.
They also
from.
Cut to, I love her backdrops. They also have, they have a great scene where Fred Willard's character is talking to somebody over the phone. Like somebody who they've booked on a vacation, and he goes, no, don't worry about it. Listen, Montezuma's Revenge is just good old fashioned diarrhea.
I don't remember that line at all.
And you just
is there a chance that that's an extra scene?
I don't think so.
Really?
I could be wrong.
I mean, I don't have that movie memorized.
I mean, I just and you just I would love to know the other 10 things Fred Willard said into that phone.
Yeah.
It's just so
when they're rolling through lines.
Like that line has just bounced around in my head for 30 years now or something, 25 years. But anyway, all of that is to say, I actually only got the articles this morning, and it was basically when I was on my way here. And
yeah,
I have
producers. We should just say, like, the producers will send you a list of articles.
Yes.
And in my experience, and I mean, to their credit, the producers at KUOW are always very like diligent in like sending out a list of stories and then saying like, please get us your thoughts on these, you know, the night before or at least the morning of, so because we're really gonna construct the show around your feedback on these topics. Yeah. And so I always feel like they're always like really, really good about that. Ironically. I'm sorry.
A lot of people think it's ironical,
ironical
that I never prep for these shows, and the one day that I'm like, the one day that I'm like, hey, I would really like to know this stuff. And in fact, last night I was thinking, maybe they've just gotten way more chill.
Yeah.
Maybe they just so then this morning I got up and now I was starting to feel a low level of like, I want to know what articles were. I will try to read the entire Seattle Times, which by the way, they have the paper, the newsprint version at the hotel
I
I'm staying
that.
At. I'm walking around that hotel. I got a coffee in one hand.
You got to fold it under.
I got the newspaper. Mm-hmm. It's SakuraCon. There's people cosplaying everywhere around me in the hotel. That's a big, I don't want to misdescribe it, but that's a big con that gets together where there's a lot of cosplay. Okay. I just got this. I love that newspaper.
Yeah.
It time traveled me in some way just to be physically holding. I walked in the hotel room, was like, opened the newspaper, started drinking my coffee. It was just like everything was right in the world. But I was like, I do need more specificity. What are the articles I need to be filled in on? So I emailed them. And I basically said, hey, I just want to make sure I didn't miss this. And basically the response was, oh, yeah, this was in the draft folder. This was on it. It never got sent. It was in the draft. And if I hadn't have, like, raised the alarm, I mean, maybe to this very moment, we still wouldn't have even known.
But, I mean, who are the well, I don't want to put them on Front Street, but I'm also kind of surprised. Here's what I think is maybe slightly ironical, or at least maybe to people who don't know you or know more of the character of you. Because I've worked with you for a long time. I think that you have an ability to make it seem like you don't do prep or whatever. That's sort of the brand, to be like very chill, but you do prep, and whether we're doing this show or a live show or whatever it is.
Sure.
So, but knowing that you're, hey, I'm the bad, you know, you call yourself the bad boy of public radio, like whatever, you put your feet up on the desk when you're
the
hosting.
The bad man, and then eventually the bad grandpa.
Why is the bad man of public radio so much worse than the bad
worse?
Boy of public radio?
I just feel like referring to myself as a boy is so factually incorrect at this point, but what can I be that's not that?
I'm the bad boy of public radio.
I am the bad man of public radio. Come. Yeah. Come, follow me. I am the bad man.
It puts the member support in the basket.
Let me put my donation in you.
Yeah. Okay, that got weird.
It puts the public radio in the estate plans.
I do think it's ironical. I can't keep making that joke. It's just going to stick in my brain. I'm going to start mispronouncing it. That you were the one out of at least one producer, two other guests,
and a host,
that you were the one who's kind of like, guys, are we going to do this?
Exactly. That's not usually the role that I play. I think everyone else is being much more chill about it than I was being.
Who are you on with? Do you mind saying?
I don't mind saying. It's my old friend of the show, David Bose.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
From various radio programs. Uh-huh. He was even told a very scary Halloween story that was a kind of go-to for us for many Halloweens. He is going to be on, and then...
This was like conservative think tank now.
He was doing that before he got into radio, and now I think he's doing it as he does less radio. But I'm excited about that because I love Dave. I mean, he and I don't see eye to eye on politics, but I, as a person, really, really like him. And then somebody named Lex Vaughn, who runs a satirical website called The Needling, which is actually really funny.
Yes.
I went and checked it out, and I'll just be honest, and I would say this to Lex as well. There, you know, with the popularity of The Onion and things like that, there have been many satire and satirical websites started, and a lot of them have not really hit. Ones that I have really enjoyed, Reductress, I like a lot.
Yes, those are the Needling and Reductress.
And this Needling one, I was like, well, let me go check this out. It's really good.
Yes.
It's funny. I was lolling.
Oh, so it hasn't been on your radar?
I had never heard of it before, like 2 days ago, and I went to check it out, and I was very, very impressed. I thought it was really funny. They have a sports section that was making me laugh out loud. I mean, the whole thing was really, really well done and very funny.
I don't go there as a destination. I like sort of, you know, a lot of Needling things get shared and reshared, and so I see them. But here's what I really think is interesting about this. Only for us, though. This is so not the interesting part of the story
kids,
for anybody else.
Hey, kids, gather around the phonograph.
Yeah. Hey, don't you wish you would have paid better attention in school? Now you got to listen to this.
Board straight.
TBTL. Board straight. We got to write that down. I heard Lex on The Week in Review a couple of months ago or something, but it was after the time that I'd already been invited on. And you know that when they invited me on, I said this to you off the air. Mm-hmm. I don't even think I said this on the air, but I was pretty sure that the producer accidentally booked me because they were were trying to book you.
Which is the most Andrew response of all time.
I truly did believe that.
No basis for
that. I'm still not 100% sure that wasn't part of what happened, but either way.
The idea that two people would mix us up is ludicrous.
Well, that is definitely true. I'm kind of the cute one. I just thought, like, Bill said, hey, my friend hosts Too Beautiful to Live. You should get him on the show. And then the producer reached out to the wrong guy.
So not what happened, but okay.
But either way, I was in my head about the whole thing, and then I heard Lex on, and I'd never heard Lex on the radio before, and they back announced that, you know, they're on the editor in the chief of the Needling, and I was like, oh, that's maybe why I'm on. Maybe they're trying to have, like, policy person, think tank person, or, like, let's just put that, like, a policy person, a reporter person, and then a wild card. You know what I mean? And I sort of thought somebody who runs a, or is the editor-in-chief of a comedy website. Is that how they describe it?
Yes.
A humor website?
Yes.
And maybe that's the role that you or I would fill. But the fact that you and Lex are both on is interesting. Yeah. That means that you are the journalist. By my
I'm the journalist there to push back on David Bowes' small government. musings, which I don't think is going to be good for anyone listening in Seattle. Like, if I'm the bulwark against this, we got problems. Yeah, we got real problems.
Bring a little bathtub so we can drown the government in it.
Yeah, right.
All right, here's what I'm going to propose. I'm going to make an executive decision here.
Your house, your rules.
That's right. Because I am concerned about you, because I am concerned
and
about
I appreciate
your time,
that. I appreciate
and I think
that.
We have a lot to talk about. I think that we are going to skip the dazzling donors today. We're going to thank them on Monday.
Wow.
But while we take a little break here, I have one package I'm going to open during the break.
Oh,
and
I like
I'll
it.
Share that with
I
you. When
by
we
the
come
way,
back.
Andrew. I have never been more attracted to you.
Yeah, just
I like
charge.
This take charge.
Yeah, no, you're in my territory. So we're going to do that. And we come back and we'll do top stories and we'll talk about how much you love Xfinity.
Oh my gosh, Andrew. I mean, well, we'll get to it in a minute.
Hello and welcome to Top Story.
All right, what do you have over there, my
yeah, let
friend?
Me, get this. So this is we check
do we
the,
need the this is box. Not a formal It's, what's in the box? But are we missing an opportunity?
I mean, you do like that, don't you? The,
I mean,
kind of what's in the box? And we paid a lot of money for
the,
it.
Yeah, exactly. So. Just to license David Cross saying, have some at the end of this drop.
My box. This is my box. I never travel without my box.
Oh, what's in the box?
In the first drawer, I keep my magic stone.
Oh, what's in the box?
You're hearing
licorice.
Andrew react
licorice.
To what's in the box.
Sweet licorice, black sweet licorice.
Okay.
Have some.
Have some.
Have some.
This is a very thoughtful little care package from a listener, Elizabeth in Ballard. I'm going to hand you the note, but I'm going to tell you what's in there before even reading the note. One is a book that is very, very, very special to me. It is from the Mixed Up Files of Mrs. Basil Lee Frankweiler.
Oh, my gosh,
a young adult novel that
Very popular book.
One of my favorite books of all time. And E.L. Konigsberg, I ended up getting to meet her one time because she is my friend, or was my friend's aunt. Rest in peace. I have a little bit
of... Is that a Caldecott Award? Winners out with
I
that
believe,
gold.
Is it Newberry?
Oh, Newberry.
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 Yeah, yeah, baby.
Ooh, that's
doing
the good
Newberry.
One.
Yeah, this is
Caldecott
so,
is for fools.
So I've talked about that before. I used to have a signed version of this as well. My one sort of cringy memory is I said a quick hello to E.L. Konigsberg, but I did not really like kind of. Maybe I didn't even say hello. I might have been too shy. Mm. She was, you know, she was.
Was it at like an event?
It was at my friend's wedding. So my friend was getting a very, very close friend of Genevieve's who she grew up with and is now a friend of mine. I was at her wedding and her aunt or great aunt was E.L. Konigsberg. And so she was there. And I think I was too shy. I didn't want to just be the zillionth person to say how much your work means to me. But you know what? I could have told her how much her work means to me. But I really think this is sweet. So a fresh copy of From the Mixed Up Files of Miss Basil Lee Frankweiler. And this I love. A DVD, Luke.
I can't see what he's got a Dell
a
computer
DVD
blocking my view, so I'm gonna find out with all of you at the same time.
A movie starring Vincent D'Onofrio and Renee Zellweger.
The whole wide world.
It's all he's ever known. It's all he ever wants to know. The worst trailer in movie trailer history. It is sublime.
But I will say this. Because it is a DVD, I bet you the trailer is on the DVD.
You're right.
This is the perfect. This is the perfect format.
I have a DVD player right here. Can I run it? I don't know if I can run.
I would love. And I'll tell you this, Andrew. This is the story of the guy who wrote Conan the Barbarian,
exactly,
right?
Exactly, yes. But it's like this over the trailer. I've never seen the movie, but the trailer is this super overwrought.
Yes.
Like dramatic, sexual dramatic journey of his, of him trying to write the truth
now,
of like Conan books.
Now the thing is, I don't want to throw anyone under any buses, but there is a very, in like a large font, there's a review on the back. Uh-huh. Terrific. A touching and near flawless love story written by William Arnold of the Seattle Post-Intelligencer.
Do you know him?
No, but I'm just like, was Seattle, Seattle the place where this movie really resonated? Also, let me read this if I can, the letter attached to this,
yeah,
the note.
Please, I'd like to
hear. Hi, Andrew, just a couple of items for your enjoyment. It was fun to reread the book. I'd always remembered it fondly. Feel free to keep it or donate it as you like. As for the movie, I saw it cheap in the used aisle at Scarecrow, where I was not that long ago.
Why were you at Scarecrow?
It was me and Ken Jennings wandering around Scarecrow. It didn't end up in the TV story, but we filmed there as another side of Ken Jennings. He's on the board of Scarecrow Video.
Oh, I didn't know that. So you guys came up to Seattle.
Oh, you were out of town.
That in LA. Oh, I see. Because I remember when you went down to LA and you talked to him.
You
there,
were out of town. This is why you wouldn't know this. Oh. And I bought a bunch of DVDs at Scarecrow.
Oh, cool.
Because I couldn't stop myself. Because I bought like The Odd Couple.
Uh-huh.
And
the movie.
The movie, yeah. The like Jack Lemmon, Walter Matthau one. And I can't even remember the other two that I bought. But it was like what I was saying on the show when you weren't here was, I figured out the store that if I go into it, I'm incapable of leaving without something.
Yeah.
And it's Scarecrow Video.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there's something about that physical media, the smell of a video store. Elizabeth says, I saw this cheap on the used aisle at Scarecrow and I couldn't resist it. Not good. Feel free to toss. It's not worth donating. So this is where Elizabeth and Bill Arnold of the Seattle Post-Intelligencer are really part company.
That's right.
Signed Elizabeth, listener Elizabeth, who is a Ballard 10.
That is so sweet.
Thank
I just
you.
Love the fact that like Genevieve and I literally were in a movie theater in the early 2000s, I believe, or maybe my timeline's wrong, maybe we rented something, but we saw this trailer for The Whole Wide World. It immediately became an inside joke between us, and also some inside jokes within inside jokes, because I never admitted that it was Vincent D'Onofrio. I always thought it was the guy from Encino Man.
But Brendan Fraser.
I always said it was Brendan Fraser. Mm. We would fight about that, whatever. And I just love the fact that like this 23-year-old weird inside joke is now
this
shared
is as
with
much
Elizabeth
a gift for Genevieve
Ballard.
As
yes,
it is a gift for
exactly.
you.
Thank so, you. That's very thoughtful.
That is way cool. You know what was not thoughtful, Andrew, was whoever at Xfinity thought, let's go ahead and let's charge more for baseball games. I guess they would blame the Mariners organization for this, Root Sports.
No, it was a Comcast decision.
It was a Comcast decision.
Yeah, so can I just do the little
bit
of background?
Yeah, will you do the setup? Because you actually know, much like the Seattle political scene, you know more about this than I do. Can you kind of set it up?
I think we talked about this. I know I talked about this a lot just with friends and maybe on other podcasts, and I'm pretty sure that you and I got into it as well, because as much as I love baseball.
Oh, we got into it.
As much as I love baseball, the current situation with these billionaire owners just like trying to, especially here in Seattle, I feel like trying to squeeze every last dime out of the fans is getting really, really frustrating for me on various levels. And this last one that happened during the offseason was especially galling. Now, I'm not even somebody who pays for cable in my house, but basically, if you're somebody who has Comcast cable, and a reason for that for a lot of people, I think, in this region is for the live sports, for access to Mariners games, because they're not over the air at all. The Comcast people made the decision to move Root Sports, the station where you can watch Mariners games, up into a more expensive tier. Now, Root
I can
Sports,
tell you exactly the tier now, by the way.
Yeah, and Root Sports, like, they didn't necessarily want that because it's not good for them. The Mariners basically also own, it's one of those team-owned networks. It just is all just, it's all just money scratching money.
Yes.
It's just so bad. But either way, the Mariners technically didn't want this because they want more eyeballs on their product. But definitely, The Xfinity is going to make more money off of this. And then that actually led to a lot of grumbling at the beginning of the offseason when, like, kind of, you know, teams were trading. It looked like the Mariners were dumping a bunch of salary, not to put it back into the team, but basically just to protect the profit of John Stanton and the other people in the ownership.
They were
group.
Saying that the baseball team was saying to the cable people, well, if you're going to put us in a more expensive bracket of cable service, we cannot charge as much for our advertising because fewer people will be watching us. And because we're losing money now on priceless granite TV commercials and stop freaking call, because we're losing money on Bobby Wagner tackling people with plumbing problems.
I think Marshawn is still doing
he
that.
He still
too,
is.
By the way.
God,
young
I love
Marshawn.
That. Yes. Like, boy, did he ever sign a life rights deal with Beacon Plumbing. But like, because they're going to make less money on their advertising, on their TV network, because not as many people will see it, because there's essentially more paywall now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because of that, we now can't pay our players. We can't spend money on good players because we're losing money on, we're not making as much money on our television product.
And by the way, there's no salary cap. There's no reason why they quote unquote can't.
No.
It's just about, and again, it's not even about the ownership taking a loss. It's about them getting less profit.
Exactly. And that is why somehow this weird confluence of sort of the, what we care about on the field, which is the Mariners winning, and what is annoying to us, which is having to pay more money to watch the baseball games, those working at cross purposes in this way is just maddening on so many levels. It's like an annoying television customer experience, and it's a devastating baseball fan experience, and all kind of crashing into each other.
And I guess you're not in King County, but still, in theory, our tax dollars are also going towards maintaining that stadium and that experience where I literally bought an $18 beer last season.
So we talked about this when it happened that it's going to, I didn't realize because I don't, outside of the Mariners, watch a lot of root sports. I clearly did not watch any Blazer games.
Yeah, right.
That's what
yeah.
I've learned. Or Kraken.
Yeah.
I have not watched, you know what? I'll raise my hand. I have not watched any Blazers or Kraken game. I know that because yesterday at about 6:30, as our text chain was starting to pop off a little bit and we're all getting excited, and it was kind of the sun had come out, I was feeling baseball-y, and I went to, and again, even without this, I spend way too much money on my cable television so that I can have this experience, Andrew. When it's time for the game, I pick up my remote control and I turn it on and I start watching the game.
Exactly.
That's the whole reason that I do this, because
you
I
even
don't
talk into the remote. Seattle Mariners. You're not getting HDMI cables out of your drawer the way I am.
Exactly. And I'm not, I just don't want any interruption in my ability to enjoy this thing when I want to enjoy it. I don't want any hassle. And I pay so much money to ensure that there will never be any hassle. Well, of course, I go to that channel and it gives me this screen that says, this is not part of your package.
You must upgrade.
You must upgrade. And I'm annoyed, but I'm like, well, I knew this was coming. I go to the Xfinity website, which is almost as bad as using the Xfinity phone service, which is really amazing. But their website is as bad as their phone thing, because if you're willing to sit there with your laptop and go to the URL that's listed on the television screen, as I was, at that point, it should be fairly straightforward.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know me, my normal thing is I want to call someone. I want to see if I can get a deal. I want to see if I can grease the wheels on things. In this one, I was like, you know what? The game's starting in 35 minutes. I just want to watch the game. I know that I'm going to break down and pay this money. I'm going to upgrade to this larger package of whatever.
I can't remember what it is. When you look at it monthly, it's like, oh, okay, I guess it's somewhat reasonable. But at the end of the year, it's in the hundreds of dollars.
Yeah, because it's also impossible to know what you're really paying, because here's what happens. I finally hack into the mainframe and I'm looking at my account and it's showing me the one that I have, which is like 125 channels. Plus I have the, you know, we'll call it the premium package, which it's like how now like a small soda is like, they've renamed everything. Yeah. I have the premium package, but it's also the fewest number of channels I can have.
Wait, you want the family everything plan.
Precisely. Get Kumail Nanjiani in here. It was like, I have the premium package. That should be the, like, that sounds pretty premium. And I'm looking at it. It's like, no, you don't have Root Sports. So then I go up to the next one.
increased a monthly bill by $18.50 to get into this new premium family premium level.
So then, like, I go, okay, well, I have premium, but that's not enough. So I go over to the next column, and it's like extra premium. And that's like 140 plus channels. And I scroll down to where it says Root Sports, not included. I go up to the next one. I have to go up to the highest amount of channels, which is 185 channels plus.
Are you looking at that? I'm just
Ultimate or something?
It's called Ultimate. It's just like they keep on creating more and more.
It's so
Ultimate Premium.
Right?
No, oh, you wanted the Ultimate Premium.
You've worked hard, Mr. Burbank. You deserve Ultimate Premium luxury in your channel selection of, by the way, easily 180 channels I don't care about.
Yeah, of course, just to watch that.
185 plus is 180 more channels than I really will. You know what the channels I will watch are? Root Sports, MSNBC, and Fox and CBS, because they have the Seahawks games.
Okay, and you and Seahawks games also over the air, by the way. That's one thing to say for football. A lot of people have said, Andrew, just get yourself a digital antenna and you can watch those. Again, like, I sort of feel like there is a tax component of this and just a city component of this that they should be over the airwaves.
So I'm annoyed that I'm having to jump through these hoops, but it's also, this is a slow speed crash. I know that it's happening. I'm trying to turn into the slide, but it's inevitable. I am going to pay this extra $18 a month.
You're just like, I'm going to pay for this.
Because I love baseball, and I'm also, by the way, the game hasn't started, so I'm just brimming with optimism. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this is going to be the season, and I'm going to have such a fun, the next, you know, 6 months of my life or whatever are going to be so much fun, because I'm going to be coming in and out of this room, and the Mariners are going to be on, and I'm going to be grilling and chilling, and it's like, I create this whole fantasy life for myself that involves this baseball team being on this television. And so, all right, I'm doing it. Oh, by the way, the reason you can't ever tell what it's costing you is because the other channel, the other packages, when you look at them, so I have whatever, premium or something. When I look at like premium plus, whatever the next one up is, it lists it as costing me negative $18 a month. In other words, my price is going to go down allegedly because I have this lever selected that is basically showing me packages where I'm now obligating myself to two more years of like coverage. Oh, you know how they do that whole situation?
So not only you can't just buy this and dump it or whatever after 6 months or what have you, you're locked
in. I can't figure out what, well, no, I can, but what they're trying to do is brain trick me so that I'm going like, wait, I'm getting Ultimate Premium, but it's $20 less a month?
I can't afford not to give them my money.
What kind of a fool would turn this deal down? And it's like, well, because what I'm doing is signing a cell phone contract with them that, like, yeah, they're taking the price down, but I can never get out of the contract for X. You know what I mean? It's just every possible way. But one, Andrew, every possible way that this system could be making me angry, except the final, the piece de resistance, the coup de Gras, the coup de Jacob deGrom on this whole situation is I finally click, I add it to my cart and I click next and it just spins and spins and gives me an error message. Sorry, I actually took a picture of it, Andrew. It just says like, sorry, we're having trouble. Please try again.
Probably because it was right before the baseball game.
And exactly.
I went on, I don't usually go on the website that I call Twitter, but you and I were texting a little bit about this last night, and this infuriates me so much. And I was like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to hate scroll on Twitter. I just went to Twitter and typed in Root Sports and just read tweet after tweet after tweet of people like, and as I suspected, like, I listen to sports radio all the time. I was pretty plugged into this whole story about the price increase and everything. But I was like, I'll bet you a lot of casual Mariners fans just
figured this out last night at the moment I did.
At 7 o'clock when they turned on their TV to watch a 7:10 game. And it's just like, and so I think the website, I'm guessing, was crashed because all these people were just like, what the hell? Now I got to upgrade. And the Comcast couldn't even take their money.
Exactly. The fact that these evil bastards, your bastard people, that's our second or third Wade Guffman reference.
So like, you're telling me.
So I'm not getting anything. I'm not getting any money. Well, our whole budget, that's our whole budget, and that includes swimming. Well, there's no swimming in my show. Like, the idea that these billionaires and billion-dollar companies would would exert their will on us in this way that makes me feel impotent, like I say, not in the good way. And then when I finally break, when I kiss the ring, when they turn me into Reek from Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
When I go full Reek on it and I'm willing to just give them more of my money. You never go full Reek. When I'm willing to just like, okay, you know what? I'll pay you an extra $20 a month, an extra $400 a year, whatever the math is, for literally 180 channels that I will never, ever, ever use. I am giving you all of this so I can have this one thing, which is my baseball team. And then they haven't even put in the redundancies in their system to account for the fact that 100,000 other people had the same experience, that they couldn't have seen this coming, that there was no way on the horizon for them to go, yeah, you know what? 7 o'clock on Thursday, March 28th is probably going to be a big day for our website.
Yeah. Yeah.
That they couldn't figure that out. You know what?
They're a website company.
You know what did work, Andrew? The site that you forwarded me.
The janky site, yeah.
I clicked on it. You know what I was doing within 30 seconds? Watching the Seattle flipping Mariners
yeah.
throw hittable pitches to Rafael Devers.
I don't usually brag about stealing media because I feel like in most
this
cases,
is,
like with
I
journalism,
think,
with photography, with that stuff is really important to me
yeah.
that the people who create those things aren't like just sort of invisible and we assume everything is free and because that's how we lose journalists and photojournalists.
Yes, exactly.
And the field shrinks. Having said that, like it's a moral obligation for us to steal.
Yes.
I do want to say this. I did get a very nice email from a listener saying, hey, could you kind of just quietly on the DL send me a link? That's kind of where I draw the line, only because I feel it's unprofessional of me to start sending gray market links to
yes.
listeners.
Yes.
So I do have to draw the line there. I'm really sorry that I'm but I also think that if you're listening to the show, you're smart enough to figure it out.
Yes.
They're out there. Do a little Googling. You
they're
can
surprising.
Figure
they're right there in plain sight. I'm surprised.
The
first time I asked you, could you just like kind of tip me off on this? I thought it was going
to
be the dark net.
Yeah. I mean,
and
you
it's
do
not.
Have to,
it ain't Silk Road.
You do have to be very patient with pop-ups and stuff when it's first happening. And it might be scary if you're somebody who does not play on the scuzzier side of the internet from time to time. But the pop-ups are not anything filthy. And I've never gotten any kind of a virus or something that my computers couldn't handle. I did want to, while you were going through that, Luke, and I was texting with you a little bit, and by the way, we don't have to get into it. I realized the text that I sent you that I was trying to be helpful about was probably not helpful in the moment.
It didn't bother me.
Really?
It really didn't.
You were like, I thought I already paid for this, and I sent you a off of the main text chain. I was just like, hey, listen, that increase happened since the last baseball season. I'd be surprised if you actually upgraded. But I was kind of like, that's not what he needs to hear right now. He's figuring it out. Like,
I didn't take.
I'm really
that,
glad to hear that.
That didn't make me. Because when I said in our sports chat, I was like, and I think I already have it. It was just because my sense of going through life right now. And I think a lot of people have this. And it's good that we skip the dazzling donors today because TBTL plays right into this.
Yeah.
The sense we have in life is like, aren't I always just going fine, $5 more?
Right, yeah.
I feel like I'm always going, fine.
How did you not have it? Right.
Fine. My memory is, I would have told you if you woke me up out of a dead sleep, did you have an annoying experience where you told Xfinity/Comcast,
right.
fine? I would be like, yeah, I did have that. And I hadn't. I mean, let's take this
it
as
a... It was a Wednesday and the whole wide world was on and you're like, fine, I'll take
it's
the...
It's all Luke's ever Uber known.
Super.
It's all
yeah.
he'll ever know.
Yeah.
I was just like, you know, I must have just caved on this at some point. But I didn't, which I'm kind of happy about, because what it means is I wasn't at least paying for this for the last 6 months.
Exactly.
So at least there's that.
So I just wanted to add a little bit more fuel to this just anti-capitalist fire, I guess, because here was my experience yesterday. Before
rent is theft.
Before you even got to that spot and we started texting about it, I had my own little experience with Major League Baseball. So there is an app and you know a service, MLB TV, where you can essentially watch every game except for your own team's games, right? Mm-hmm, and it's about $150 for the season to buy this thing. I pay like $20 at the beginning of the season, so I get radio access to all the games. And then around this time of year, because I'm a T-Mobile customer, and this is honestly one of the reasons I remain a T-Mobile customer for this perk, which is I get free MLB TV. But there's a short window in which I need to sign up for it, but they're like, this is $150 value. So I take that at face value. I'm basically paying $150 for this thing. It's given to me free through T-Mobile, but still, it's something that I'm essentially paying for, and it's legal. So it's about 2 hours before the Mariners game. I'm hungry for some baseball. And so the Cubs are playing, the Rangers.
Give me baseball.
So I'm listening to the game, and I'm like, this is good. Then I'm like, oh, I need to get some work done. So I sit down behind my computer, and I'm like, oh, I'll sign up for my free MLB TV. I can actually watch this game now. Again, I want to point out this is the Chicago Cubs and the Texas Rangers. I go through.
There aren't any Akron groomsmen on that Cubs team, are there?
All of this. Yeah. Well, there was. And I go through all of this rigmarole to like sign up for it. And you know, the handshake is never perfect from my one account talking to the other account, but I get to figure it out pretty quickly. But it doesn't seem to be working. I'm like, why is it not working? And then I realized they blacked out that game for me. It's not even a local team, which that is backwards anyway. It's like you can pay $150 for a season and then not watch your team. You can only watch out-of-market games. Which
why
even
in the
then,
world would it be blacked out?
I'm guessing that maybe Major League Baseball was just like, well, it's opening day. People are more interested in these games, and so we can squeeze
money
out of
them. Probably some sort of national broadcast. It was probably on MLB Network.
That might have been it.
Because
that might have been it.
These cool teams, and it's the opening day. So because they're not playing, because you're not just watching it, you're not just dipping into like the Chicago, you know, feed of it, because it's a highlighted game.
Yeah.
It's being presented in this special way that takes it off the list of games that they have to let you
that
watch.
That you essentially paid $150 to watch, right? It's just kind of like, no, we don't let you watch all the games. We just let you watch the Wednesday games.
Oh, my God.
But here's another example of like, you're paying for cable. You can't watch the game. I'm essentially paying for MLB TV. Oh, but you can't watch the game because it's blacked out. And then so you and I are texting about the Comcast thing, and I'm getting more and more steamed. By the way, I did watch part of that Cubs game through an illegal stream.
Yes.
After I just essentially legally paid for the service. And I'm just in my head about it. And then the game is about to start, and I'm watching the Mariners game on my computer, Luke. And your friend and Seattle, the pride of Seattle, Ben Gibbard, is going to sing the national anthem.
Oh, nice.
And they, the announcer is announcing all the players are doing the full roster. It's opening day. It's a big deal.
I want to live in amber waves of grain.
That wasn't bad. But before they introduce him, the announcer, which I think for this part of the broadcast is probably both the announcer that I'm hearing on television and the announcer in the park.
Probably Tom Hutt 1, Hutt 2, Huttler.
Is that it? Yeah. The low voice. Please turn your attention. And he didn't say the flag. He said, to our grand American flag presented by Starbucks.
Oh.
And my head almost exploded. They are sponsoring the American flag. They are taking Starbucks money to sponsor the American flag, and I can't watch baseball games that I'm paying for. By the way, I'm going to the game on Tuesday.
All right, let's do a little music for your weekend, but a sort of modified version, because you're right, Andrew, I should probably be, well, first of all, reading about the Grizzlies' reintroduction to the Pacific Northwest.
Is that one of your topics, really?
One of the topics. That's something I already know a lot about, thank God.
Right.
So, I mean, literally, I sent him a list of just like meaningless, dumb hot dog stories that I could just vamp on. And then the response was, how about these policy issues?
Oh, I really thought that you were going to get a good week where it was all going to be like the fun stuff, the Costco hot dog stories and what have you.
But I do need to get to that. So let's do this. We're gonna kind of keep this compact today. And in fact, you know what we're going to do? We're going to just do one song.
Okay, cool. And just so you know, so the listeners don't think that you're bullying me out of my music for your weekend, all this morning I was like, I don't have a new song. I was going to replay something I played about a year ago. So
I actually have, there are some good listeners. Because I mentioned yesterday on the show, Andrew, that we're starting over on email.
Yeah.
And that if people want to get a music for your weekend and this is a good time, that worked.
Oh,
I got a bunch of submissions and a bunch of them are really good. So if you've sent that in, just know that I'm organizing those and I'm watching this space. But because we're a little crunched for time today, and because it happens to be the actual birthday of my friend and noted Seattle Mariner fan, also my brother, maybe critically my brother, my friend, and noted Seattle Mariners fan, David Burbank, David from the basement. He reached out and says, "Hey, fellas, I wanted to suggest a song for music for your weekend this Friday. While I could have suggested literally any song from the new Waxahachie record."
Oh,
by the way, the other day on the show, I was saying how I was describing a certain kind of lifestyle, and it was involving having Waxahachie on vinyl, having Monstera plants, and wearing a wide-brimmed hat. Mm-hmm. And David then took a video, which he put into Hawk Squad, where he's in his home showing his Waxahachie vinyl record and his Monstera plants while wearing a wide-brimmed hat.
Wait, he stage it?
I think he said something to the effect of he felt very called out or called in by this.
Uh-huh.
So I mean the album and the plants were there. Maybe he put the hat on.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, today happens to be my brother David's birthday, and he said suggest anything off the new Waxahachie record. Instead, I want to suggest the song "Pink Pony Club" by Chapel Roan.
Okay.
You guys have probably heard Chapel's mm-hmm. music at this point. She was just on Tiny Desk and is about to absolutely explode on the scene. David, I couldn't agree more. I have been having this thought about Chapel Roan for a while. Chapel Roan is someone that if you have not heard of her, you will be hearing mm-hmm. of her, because she's touring. She's got all these songs that are really blowing up. She played Colbert. She's in that phase of a music career where I think she's playing probably like 2,000 person venues and they're sold out.
Hmm.
And the kids, the young people are doing, they have motion, hand motions for songs. Like mm-hmm. they spell out some of the songs with like almost kind of like YMCA, but uh-huh. to the words. Like the obsession with this Chapel Roan person is huge. You are going to be hearing about her this summer. And by the way, this album, it's called The Rise and Fall of a Midwest Princess, is really, really good. Mm. It's pop music, but it's pop music that really has a point of view. It's really catchy. Anyway, I'm enjoying from afar. I'm a little old for the Chapel Roan phenomenon.
So I was basing in on the Waxahachie conversation leading into this and the cover of this particular single in which she's wearing a wide brimmed hat and it's all pink and it's called Pink Pony Club. I thought this was going to be sort of Waxahachie adjacent. This isn't countrified.
It's not countrified. It's much more poppy.
Okay.
In fact, I said to Becca, I was like, have you heard of Chapel Roan? And she was like, no. I go, she's like the next Olivia Rodrigo.
Oh,
and then
okay.
I looked up, she's touring with Olivia Rodrigo.
There you go. Okay.
So remember that whole, you said forever, now I drive alone past your street? That was Olivia Rodrigo.
Oh, okay.
That's about to happen with this person, Chapel Roan. So we're going to go with that. And by the way, David adds, P.S., it's my birthday on Friday, so you have to play my song.
Yeah, this is a little manipulative.
Honestly, I don't feel good about it.
I'm not sure I want to platform this, honestly.
Seriously. Yeah. David said, it's my birthday, so I need you to upgrade to the ultimate tier package of brotherhood.
You need to be the only.
But then I click on it, and it says, sorry, it's not working. Try again. So all right.
Earlier today, during the show, I said that would be a good show title, and you said, I'll write it down. Bored Straight. Okay, good. We'll go with that. And here is Pink Pony Club.
I can't speak for her. Chapel Roan is definitely not shy about talking about physical matters and self-love. And I see the name Pink Pony Club, and I don't think it's not about.
Oh, maybe. That's interesting. Yeah, and didn't you last week play Wet Dream by Wet Leg?
I did.
Things are getting fresh.
Something's stirring.
It's springtime, baby.
All right, thanks for listening. We'll see you on Monday. Until then, have a great weekend, and please remember, no mountain too tall.
And good luck to all.
Every single day, I'm having wicked dreams of leaving Tennessee. If Santa Monica, I swear it's calling me. Won't make my mama proud, it's gonna cause a scene. She sees her baby girl, I know she's gonna scream. God, what have you done? You're a pink pony girl, and you dance at the club. It's where I belong, down at the...
What I need from you, because you're the bosses of the town, essentially, and I know that, is, this is so hard, I need more money.
Wow.
We want
how much
you.
Do you need?
Steve's right. How much are you thinking on now?
Okay. What I need is $100,000.
Oh, brother. he's not kidding.
Harky, our entire budget for the entire year is $15,000 for everything, and that includes swimming. Well, I don't have any swimming in my
ship. No, I mean the pool.
Power out.